Hello everyone, in this video I'll be talking about ear discharge. Now ear discharge, it is not a disease, it is a symptom. Ear discharge is present in many ear pathologies, so a proper history taking is important, and there are certain questions pertaining to the discharge which help us in reaching the diagnosis. Now, ear discharge can be because of various conditions of either external ear or middle ear. So the common external ear conditions causing ear discharge, they are otitis externa. Otitis externa, it is the infection and inflammation of the external ear, pinna and external auditory canal. Then otomycosis, which is again the fungal infection of external ear. The common fungi are Aspergillus niger and Candida albicans. Then furunculosis. Furunculosis, it is a staphylococcal infection of the hair follicle, which are present in the outer one third of the canal, which is the cartilaginous part. Then malignant otitis externa. It is a misnomer. It is a condition caused by Pseudomonas, generally seen in patients with uncontrolled diabetes and who are immunocompromised, in which there is infection of the external ear which is fast growing and it affects the adjacent structures. That is why it is called malignant otitis externa. Then parotid abscess. Now there are micro connections between the parotid and the external auditory canal in the form of fissures of Santorini. So infection from either side can lead to ear discharge. Then ear discharge can be because of some skin conditions like eczema and seborrhea. Now, there are some causes in the tympanic membrane which lead to ear discharge. They are granular meningitis, in which there is formation of granulation tissue in the over the tympanic membrane. Then bullous meningitis, where bulla are formed over the tympanic membrane. These are fluid filled bulla, so when they rupture it causes ear discharge. And sometimes retraction pockets also, they lead to the collection of the fluid in the ear and leads to ear discharge. Then causes of the middle ear which cause ear discharge, the common causes are acute suppurative otitis media and chronic suppurative otitis media. Then some neoplasm in the canal and the middle ear can also lead to ear discharge. For example, some benign neoplasms like glomus tumor, when they are secondarily infected, they can cause ear discharge. Then malignant conditions of the middle ear, squamous cell carcinoma, it can cause ear discharge. Then some general granulomatous conditions of our body, for example vaginous granulomatosis, sarcoidosis, SLE, they can also affect the ear and lead to ear discharge. So when CSF comes out from the ear, it is called CSF otorrhea. CSF otorrhea can be because of fracture of the temporal bone. Fracture of the temporal bone can be longitudinal fracture or transverse fracture with respect to the petrous part. Now the generally longitudinal fracture, CSF rhinorrhea, CSF otorrhea, it is more commonly seen. Then there can be CSF otorrhea because of defect in the tegmen plate, that is dural plate, which separates the middle ear from the middle cranial fossa. CSF otorrhea also can be because of any cochlear deformity, congenital deformity, or one condition in which there is congenital tympanomeningeal fissure present, which leads to CSF otorrhea. It is called Hertel's disease. Now, whenever a patient comes in ENT OPD with a complaint of ear discharge, it is always a proper history taking which is important, and there are certain characteristics of the ear discharge which can lead to the reaching a diagnosis. So first of all, we ask whether the discharge is unilateral or bilateral. Which side is affected, that we should ask. Then we should ask about the smell of the discharge. Then what is the quantity of the discharge? What is the consistency of the discharge? What is the color of the discharge? And whether the discharge is present on during the visit, which is active, or it is absent, which is inactive. So we'll see these characteristics one by one. Smell of the discharge. If it is foul smelling, we can say that it is because of unsafe type of chronic otitis media, that is etiquental type of CSM, that like for example cholesteatoma. In cholesteatoma, the discharge is foul smelling because there is bone necrosis, and that bone necrosis is because of the enzymatic destruction of the bone, The enzymes being acid phosphatases, collagenases, and proteolytic enzymes, which are secreted by the osteoclast. They destroy the bone and then they lead to foul smelling discharge. So if a patient is complaining of foul smelling discharge, we can think of chronic suppurative otitis media of etic ventral variety. In the other variety, that is tubotympanic variety, generally it is a non-foul smelling discharge. However, if there is superadded bacterial infection, then rarely there can be foul smelling discharge in tubotympanic also. But as such, foul smelling discharge is a characteristic feature of etic ventral type of CSUN. Regarding consistency of the discharge, it can be stringy or mucoid in consistency. That is when we clean the ear, or the patient can also say that when the ear discharge is cleaned with the earbud, the discharge gets stretched like string of pearls. So that is called a stringy discharge. And stringy discharge means that it is mucoid and it is coming from the middle ear, because the mucus secretory glands and the goblet cells, they are present in the middle ear, which secrete the mucoid discharge. Then another type of consistency can be non-stringy or serous discharge. And serous discharge, it comes from the external ear, which can be in the case of otitis externa, because external ear does not have mucus secretory glands. So it produces serous discharge. And if the discharge is watery in consistency, then it can be because of CSF otorrhea, the causes of which we have already seen. The color of the discharge can be creamy yellow, which indicates it is pus. For example, in acute suppurative otitis media or chronic otitis media, it can be greenish. It implies that there is Pseudomonas infection, or it can be blood stained. So an important point is, what are the causes of blood stained ear discharge? So they can be granulations in the middle ear, more commonly with etic ventral type of CSUN than with tubotympanic. Secondly, malignancy. Any squamous cell carcinoma of the external or the middle ear will lead to blood stained discharge. Or if there is any trauma, then it also leads to blood stained ear discharge. The quantity of the ear discharge. Now, as such, we cannot exactly measure the quantity of the discharge, but by asking some questions from the patient, we can have an idea of the quantity. For example, if the patient says that the ear discharge is present only in the deeper parts of the canal, and during cleaning of the ear with earbuds, the buds get stained, then it is called scanty discharge. And scanty discharge, it is a feature of etic ventral type of chronic suppurative otitis media. Then another category of discharge is moderate, in which the discharge is present only in the external auditory canal, it does not come out, then it is called moderate. And if the discharge comes out from the canal, it stains the cloth of the patient, or it stains the pillow, then it is called profuse discharge. Now, moderate and profuse discharge, they are generally seen with tubotympanic type of chronic otitis media, while scanty discharge, it is a feature of etic ventral type of chronic otitis media. Then another characteristic of discharge is whether it is active or inactive. Active means that when the patient comes to the OPD, the discharge is present, then we say it is active disease. Inactive means the discharge is absent at least since 6 weeks. So the patient was having discharge 6 weeks back, but till now there is no discharge. Then there is third term, which is called quiescent. Quiescent means that discharge disappears for a few days and then it reappears. So that is called a quiescent discharge. Active, inactive, and quiescent. So based on the qualities or the characteristics of the discharge, we can get an idea only from the history of the patient, that the patient is having a tubotympanic type of otitis media or etic ventral type. So the discharge in the tubotympanic type, it is intermittent. Intermittent means it is relieved by medication. So when the patient uses eardrops or takes medicines, then there will be some period of reminiscence where there will be no discharge. However, in etic ventral type of disease, the discharge is always continuous. It is not relieved by medication. Then based on the amount, as we saw in tubotympanic, the discharge is mostly profuse and moderate, and in etic ventral disease, it is a scanty discharge. Then the consistency, in tubotympanic, it is mucoid, it is coming from the middle ear, and in etic ventral, it is mucopurulent rather, pus is also there. Then smell, in tubo tympanic it is generally non-foul smelling, while in atipental, because of bone destruction, there is foul smelling ear discharge. And in tubo tympanic, mostly it is not blood stained. While in atipental disease, because of presence of active granulations, the discharge can be blood stained discharge. One more feature which we should always ask to a patient who is having ear discharge is that when the patient uses the ear drops, whether the drops are coming, he feels the drops or the taste of the drops in the throat or not. Because if the patient feels the drops coming in the throat or the taste of the drops in the throat, it means that the eustachian tube of that patient is patent. So that is a good preoperative test to know the function of the eustachian tube. Now, management of a patient with discharge. So as I told you, history is very important. We should ask all questions relevant to the discharge so that we can come to a pinpointed diagnosis. Then physical examination, that is, we should always clean the discharge, which can be done by either suction clearance under microscope. It can be also be cleaned by dry mopping using an earbud. Then for investigations, we should always send the discharge for culture and sensitivity examination to know the specific organism and its antibiotic sensitivity, and then we can change the antibiotics accordingly. Then if we are suspecting any CSF otorrhea, then we should always send that discharge for chemical analysis. If there is any history of trauma, any history of mass, or if there is a complicated CSOM, then we can go for radiology in the form of HRCT temporal bone or MRI inner ear. And if there is any mass in the ear, so we can also take a biopsy to get a diagnosis. And as such, since discharge is a symptom, so once we treat the cause of that symptom, the discharge disappears. Thank you.